In this video, a silica gel column will be prepared in a fume hood as silica is an inhalation hazard. A sample of spinach will be loaded into the column and its compounds will be separated. A silica gel column chromatography separates a mixture of compounds due to the differences in polarities. The materials you will need are a burette, a stand, a copper wire, a wad of cotton, some small Olmeyer flasks, the two solvents, acetone and hexanes, sand, silica gel, and the sample spinach. First, a wad of cotton that isn't too big or small is packed into the burette using the copper wire. The cotton will keep the silica from dripping out when making the column and performing the elution. The burette is set into a stand with a waste beaker under it. The spinach sample is dried with anhydrous sodium sulfate. Not a lot of sodium sulfate is needed. The sample is dry when the sodium sulfate doesn't clump together when shaking the scintillation vial. A pipette is then used to remove the sample from the sodium sulfate and into a small beaker. In another beaker, the silica and solvent are mixed together. In this case, the solvent is hexanes, which are nonpolar. The slurry mix should have a wet sand consistency. The slurry is poured into the burette. A stirring rod can be used to help transfer the slurry. Adding more hexanes can help move the slurry down the column. While pouring, tapping the edge of the column with a pencil helps to dispel any air bubbles as they would affect the separation of the compounds. The column is about 5 milliliters tall as a too short column would not effectively separate the compounds and a too tall column would take too long for this lab. The stopcock is then opened so the solvent can drain to the top of the silica and then closed. Using a pipette, the spinach is added to the side of the burette so it may fall to the silica column without disturbing the column. The stopcock is then opened until the spinach sinks into the top of the silica column and then closed. A layer of sand, about 0.5 centimeters thick, is added with a scoopola. This will protect the column from being disturbed when adding in the solvents to perform the elution. The 100% hexane solvent is added to the column and then the stopcock is opened to allow a steady drip that isn't too fast. This will allow the solvent to start running through the silica column and separate the compounds by their polarities. The silica is the stationary phase of the column and polar, thus more polar compounds will be attracted to it. The solvent is nonpolar, which will help elute the more nonpolar compounds from the sample. As the column runs, make sure to add solvent in order to keep the column from drying out and cracking. The waste beaker can be kept under the burette until the first fraction is collected in a 25 milliliter Olmeyer flask. We can see that the yellow band is starting to move further down than the dark green band. This will be the first fraction collected. Keep adding the 100% hexanes. In the case for this demonstration, the other solvent is 70% hexanes and 30% acetone. In lab, you may make other solvent mixes that continue to increase in polarity. By switching to a more polar solvent, we will start to elute the polar solutions from the sample. Acetone is more polar than the silica, allowing the polar compounds to be attracted to the acetone rather than the silica column. As the yellow band approaches the end of the pipette, you may switch Olmeyer flasks to collect the transitions between the bands. The next fraction collected in a new Olmeyer flask is the dark green band. The last fraction collected in a new Olmeyer flask is the lighter green band. Once this last band is collected, the column is stopped by using the stopcock. The fractions will then be analyzed using TLC analysis. The column is then left open to drip into the waste beaker. The waste is then dumped into the proper waste beakers, and the TA will take care of cleaning the column and putting away the column setup.